an all-consuming fire. You're robed in majesty, bright shining as the sun. Your ways are not our ways, your thoughts are high above. You are the fountain, Lord, of mercy, truth, and love.
Day the Lord has blessed us with. Amen. Amen. Thank you for joining us on this beautiful Sunday morning. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Pastor Dave Parker, and King of Kings is our family of faith. You are most welcome here. As is our practice lately, we are celebrating the gifts of Holy Communion each and every live stream. So if you need to, take a moment now and hit pause. Go find some bread, some grape juice, or wine, and have that ready following our sermon for today. As we experience Holy Communion this morning, even though we are not in the same room together, may you experience Jesus still bringing us together, through his body and through his blood. A couple quick announcements this morning. There is still time for any of you adults who wish to share your favorite Bible verses with us. We're going to put together a video montage, if you will, something to remember these days by, and it's really simple. For those of you with smartphones, take out your phone, okay? Go to the video part, okay? Make it so it's showing you. Hold it sideways, landscape mode. Share your name. Well, hit record. Share your name. Read your favorite Bible verse. Hit stop. Email that to me at PastorDaveParker@gmail.com. It literally will take you a minute. Okay? That's simple. And we'll compile all those together. And just have a great story. And if you don't have a favorite Bible verse, crack open that Bible, right? Or do what other people do. Google other people's favorite Bible verses. Read some of those and go, well, yeah, I kind of like that one too. So I invite you to join us for all of that. Finally, well, the two last things. So again, if you missed last Sunday, we had, I'm going to assume there were a couple of anonymous members who ran around our sanctuary and had put together every family's name in our directory, probably plus a couple more, and made little paper cutouts and pasted them all over the pews. And so even though you may be at home this morning or whenever you're watching this, your presence is here, and it's amazing. I was sharing with our Bible study earlier this week that it was so emotional for me that immediately the story of the Bible came crashing into my mind of Moses entering into the Holy of Holies when he was conversing with God, and the Lord said to him, Moses, take your shoes off. You're on holy ground. And so that hit me. So while I was like in tears last week, I had to take my shoes off. So I led the whole service barefoot. And I loved it so much, I have to do it again. So I'm barefoot. Yeah. Which the band, they never wear pants. You just can't tell. No. Just kidding. Finally, we are planning to do some outdoor service worshiping beginning on Monday night, August 10th at 7 p.m. and hopefully every Monday from then on out until it's too cold to be outside. So we invite you to come join us. And again, we have hopes to start our indoor worship on Sunday, September 13th at 11 o'clock. We'll still be doing the 9:30 live stream and then a service at 11 on Sundays and keep going with those Monday nights and go from there. And of course, all this is based on how we as a state and as a country are doing against this pandemic, but God willing, we'll start to, you know, get back to some of those practices when school is coming back as well. All right, with all that said, let's jump right into our song of praise.
My name is written on your hand. Call me your own. Call me alone. Now I am yours, no earthly power tear us apart, tear us apart. Counting on your name. Trusting you.
Amen. Well, let us pray. Beloved and sovereign God, through the death and resurrection of your Son, you bring us into your kingdom of justice and mercy. By your Spirit, give us your wisdom, that we may treasure the life that comes from Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. And all of God's people say, Amen. All right, let's get comfy. Well, sisters and brothers, grace to you and peace from God the Father and from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So I'm going to start this morning off with a bit of a brain teaser for you. So you kind of get those brain juices flowing. All right. Here's a question for you. What do dogs, diamonds, and double plays have in common? I'll give you a moment to think about it. Yeah. Dogs, diamonds, and double plays. They're all somebody's best friend, right? A dog is man's best friend, unless, of course, you have a puppy at your house that your wife is sabotaging, giving him treats all the time, and then he's women's best friend, right? Not that that's happening at our house at all. Diamonds are a girl's best friend, and double plays are a pitcher's best friend. There you go, brain teaser. How about this one? One more. What do a mustard seed, a pinch of yeast, a net full of fish, a hidden treasure, and a valuable pearl all have in common? No, they are not parts of yet another Pirates of the Caribbean movie. But according to Jesus, they are all things that share one thing in common. They are all an example of what the kingdom of heaven is like. Our gospel reading comes to us from the book of Matthew, the 13th chapter. We continue kind of where we left off last week. Start in verse 31. Jesus put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all the seeds, but when it is grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. Verse 44. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. And on finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets and threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all of this? They answered, Yeah. And he said to them, Therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out his treasure, what is new and what is old. When Jesus had finished these parables, he left that place. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So at this point, we are about halfway through our walk with the book of Matthew. We started this journey about 2 months ago now, right? The beginning of June. And as I said, we're kind of smack dab in the middle of Jesus' ministry. He's been on the road, healing, feeding, preaching, teaching all across the countryside. And today, we get more of the same. Today, Jesus is on a mission to give us something, to tell us something, to show us something about the kingdom of heaven. And he does so using 5 different parables. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed. It's like a pinch of yeast, a hidden treasure, a finest pearl, and a net full of fish. And I don't know about you, but I'm thinking it's a good time. With all that's been going on and continues to go on in our lives, all the frustrations, the sorrows, the anger, the joys, the challenges, to be reminded of something bigger in our midst. the kingdom of heaven. It's not just a destination we experience when we die. We also get a taste of it from time to time throughout this life. And again, I don't know about you, but I can always use the taste of heaven in my life. How about you? Amen? Amen? So let's dig into what Jesus has to say about heaven today. So to set the stage here at this point in the story, Jesus apparently has drawn such a huge crowd along the lakeshore there, and people wanted to hear what he had to say, that he hops into a boat and has to push away from shore a little bit so he has room to speak. He began teaching in parables, riddled metaphors, stories, and examples that would intentionally confuse people who wouldn't dig a little bit deeper or take the time to learn what he was teaching. I mean, maybe he wanted people to work a little bit and wrestle with what they believed, to turn them from their own desires, their own agendas, and to not only hear what Jesus had to say, but also to take it to heart, for people to allow it to change how they live and how they see the world around them. And after throwing all these perhaps confusing parables at the crowd, Jesus then turns to his disciples and says, "So, I know they don't get it. How about you? Do you get what I'm saying? Do you understand?" Now, Matthew tells us that they all say yes. But I'm thinking maybe it was more of a yes. I mean, you could practically hear the not really behind their answer. I mean, what's Jesus getting at here trying to describe the kingdom of heaven in so many different ways? Well, here's what I'm thinking. Looking at how a parent would explain something to their child, Kelsey, my wife, and I get a lot of experience of doing this each and every day. For instance, teaching a child about shapes. Now you tell me, could I turn to my 5-year-old son, August, and explain to him that a square is a 4-sided polygon with all sides equilateral and all internal angles at 90 degrees, also known as a quadrilateral or parallelogram, and expect him to grasp that? Of course not. However, I do remember once having in our household a cool little Barney book, and yes, I just used the word cool and Barney in the same sentence. I know, sorry. But this book had a bunch of shapes that our boys would love to look at. And in it, sure enough, there was Sydney the Square, who had 4 sides the same size. He likes to picnic and eat cherry pies. Ah, there you have it. All of a sudden, Augie could understand that. He could grasp Sydney the Square, who has 4 walls the same size. He likes to go to picnics and have cherry pies. When concepts are so big and so broad that we have a hard time understanding, it's helpful to be given examples of things that we do know so we can, if nothing else, just kind of wrap our minds around it just even a little bit to help us understand. And Jesus does the same thing today. He uses what we call parables. In today's gospel reading, Jesus finds himself with the need to explain the kingdom of heaven. I mean, talk about a massive thing, right? And he needs to explain it to a bunch of average Joes, just ordinary people, not religious scholars, not people with doctorates or able to understand all the theological terms, just normal people. I mean, were he to say that the kingdom of heaven, what it's actually like, or its actual size or scale, I imagine it'd be like trying to take a sip of water from a fire hydrant at full power, which don't do, by the way. Lips take a long time to grow back. I mean, if Jesus were to teach that way, everyone would have been staring at him with glossed over eyes, really confused. So Jesus tells them and us that in one sense, the kingdom of heaven is seemingly small or simple, like a mustard seed or yeast. But the kingdom is also something that has immense worth, like the finest pearl or a great treasure. And if that's not enough, it's also like a net that catches any and everything. To be clear, the kingdom isn't actually a seed, yeast, or pearl, treasure, or a net, but it's only like those things. Each example captures just a glimpse of something important about heaven, and it brings it down to a size and to a scale that we can at least begin to understand. These words we hear today serve as a reminder that when it comes to the enormity of God and of the kingdom of heaven, there's only so much that you and I are going to be able to grasp and understand. But this isn't to say that what we can grasp isn't enough to make a difference in our lives. Part of living into our faith is realizing that we're never going to grasp every answer, but also that the greatest and most important answer is given freely to us in a way that grasps us. The gift of Jesus Christ and the hope that comes from his life, death, and resurrection. Amen? Amen. That answer grasps us. I think Jesus offers us so many glimpses and ideas of what heaven is like today so that maybe, just maybe, at least one of these will make sense to each of us. Now, in reading all five, we could definitely probably take the next hour and break down all five of these parables. But there was one in particular that really struck me that I wanted to share with you today. The kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. Upon finding a pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Now, in the past, I've often read this parable thinking that, well, obviously, we're the merchants, right? That we're the ones searching for something extremely valuable to us. Things like purpose, acceptance, love, truth, maybe even God. And it becomes so important to us that we'll give away whatever it takes to get it because everything else pales in comparison. I remember wanting nothing more growing up than to be liked or for my parents to be proud of me. Oh, I would have given anything and everything for those pearls, right? And that's how I used to read this parable, that we're the merchants searching. And it's easy for us to read it this way. I mean, it is all about us, right? Yeah. But what hit me this week, I mean, what if we looked at this parable slightly differently? What if we aren't the merchants? What if we're the pearls? And there was someone searching for us, looking all over for you and for me. I mean, what if upon finding us, that person gave up everything because everything else paled in comparison? What if that merchant was God and upon finding you was willing to give whatever it took to get you? What if that's exactly what he did? Welcome to a taste of what the kingdom of heaven is like. In this little riddled metaphor, Jesus makes it very clear. You and I have been sought after, searched for far and wide, and upon finding you, purchased for the greatest price ever paid, life itself. All because you are worth that much to our God. That's heaven. And that's what God's kingdom is all about. And for me, knowing and believing that keeps my faith going, even in the midst of all the things that I cannot understand these days. These parables don't tell us everything that there is to know about God or about heaven, but it does give us little pieces of what we do know about our God, of things that are important for us to remember, that we have a God who can take common, insignificant things like the tiniest little mustard seed or a pinch of yeast and cause something to grow that is life-giving and amazing. That we have a God who was and still is willing to pay any price to wrap his loving arms around you. That we have a God who doesn't just want a few of us. He wants to bring in every single one of us into his nets of mercy and grace. You know, I'm a firm believer that our God's love when we experience that, especially the end of our lives, whenever that moment is, when we are caught up in that net, that love will be so overwhelming, so overpowering that our God, that the angels, as it says in this parable, won't be casting anyone away. That there will be no weeping and gnashing of teeth when that moment comes. Like I said, we don't learn everything here about God or His kingdom, but just enough to make a difference in our lives. That if we can believe some of this, that it can change our perspective on how our lives are going. To know that you have such worth and value that our God would die for you. I mean, that's life-giving stuff. We live into that until the day when the kingdom of heaven comes in all of its glory, in all of its fullness. When the seed-like, yeast-like, net-like, treasure-like, pearl-like nature of heaven is laid out in all of its splendor and majesty for us to behold. Something tells me that it won't be so confusing that day, that it won't be riddled parables for us to try to understand. We'll just simply be overpowered by the love of God. And until that day comes, we live with just the tastes of heaven in each and every moment, and every breath that we take. It's a gift from our God saying, I love you that much. May this be your experience right now and in the hours and days to come until you hear more. We ask all this in your holy and precious name, our Father. We can't thank you enough. Amen. We now join our voices for our next song of praise.
Thank you.
Confident of your care and helped by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. At the end of this time of prayer, at the end of each petition, I'll say, Lord, in your mercy, please respond with, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Merciful God, your reign is revealed to us in common things. A mustard shrub, a woman baking bread, a fishing net. Help your church witness to the surprising yet common ways you encounter us in daily life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. When your word is opened, it gives light and understanding. Increase our understanding and awe of your creation. Guide the work of scientists and researchers. Treasuring the earth, may we live as grateful and healing caretakers of our home. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As the birds of the air nest in branches of trees, gather the nations of the world into the welcoming shade of your merciful reign. Direct leaders of nations to build trust with each other and walk in your way of peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Your Spirit helps us in our weakness and intercedes for the saints according to your will. Help us when we do not know how to pray. Give comfort to the dying, refuge to the weary, justice to those who are oppressed, and healing to the sick. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You show steadfast love and direct us to ask whatever it is that we need. Help this congregation to ask boldly for what is most needed. Refresh us with new dreams of being your people in this place and time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Receive these prayers, O God, and all those too deep for words, through Jesus Christ our Lord, and all of God's people say, Amen. We'll now take a moment to reflect on our week and confess those times when we have failed to live as God would have us live. Please repeat these words after me. Loving God, we confess. We do not trust your abundance. And we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hope in ourselves and rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you provide enough for all. We abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us. Through your love, renew us. And in your Spirit, lead us, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. And now hear this, dear sisters and brothers. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given over to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by God's authority, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and all of God's people say, Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat. This is my body, and it's given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. And again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, and it's shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. At this time, I invite you to take the hands of those in your household with you, or to extend your hands out and join our hands across the internet as we pray the prayer our Lord has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I invite you at this time to prepare your communion elements. And as you do so, as you either hand out or commune yourself with the body of Christ, use these words: the body of Christ given for you. And as you either hand out or commune yourself with the blood of Christ, use these words: the blood of Christ shed for you. People of God, may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you always in God's grace. And all of God's people say, Amen. And finally, a special thank you for those who take the extra time to share God's blessings with us by either mailing in a check or by jumping over to the Donate Now or Support Us part on our website. We continue sharing our ministries only through your generosity. So thank you for sharing your blessings with us. With all that said, I invite us to join our voices in our closing song of praise.
Fullness of
Finally, may you receive this blessing.
May the road rise to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. And until we meet again, and until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of His hand.
Amen. People of God, do not be afraid, for the kingdom of heaven through God's word comes to you today to remind you how precious you are in the eyes of the Lord. Amen. So I'll see you next Sunday morning at 9:30, if not before then, through one of our online ministries. But until then, be blessed.
Hey.